Hi, and welcome back to Jen and Dan's Natural Healing with Plants. I'm Jen, your health educator, coach, and master herbalist.
And I'm Dan, your exercise specialist and fellow master herbalist. Today, we're delving into an important topic, the harmful effects of eating too much animal protein. And this is a big topic.
This is huge. And I think it's getting bigger and bigger. So meat is definitely huge here in the US. And, you know, people eat meat 3 times a day. And, you know, they say, you know, way back when people ate lots of meat, you know, when you look at some of these other diets, and that's what our body needs, lots and lots of meat. But when you think about it, tigers and lions, these giant cats who hunt for meat, they don't always get an animal. They don't always catch something. And so they don't, you know, maybe they feast and eat a lot of meat all at one time, but they don't get it every time. And so when we're thinking that people way back when ate a lot of meat, we're saying that humans way back when were better hunters than these lions and tigers.
No,
And
there's a recent study about this. They're finding now, they found a population, ancient population, and they figured they were around 80% plants to about 20% animals back then. Because like you're saying, and most of these people, these modern people that eat a lot of meat, they've never went hunting before. I used to be a hunter, and I can tell you that you usually do not go out of the woods with an animal. And that's with a gun. So can you imagine people with spears and primitive arrows? No, they said that these people would have become extinct if it wasn't for foraging. They ate a lot of root vegetables. That's how they sustain themselves.
Right. Yeah, that's just not, we're not supposed to eat lots of meat all day, every day.
No.
We definitely need lots of other things in between too. You know, I was looking at, I've been reading Eating on the Wild Side, which I read back in 2013, and I'm rereading it again. And it talks about how Native Americans would dry meat and combine it with berries and can't remember what else, but very high antioxidant foods for traveling. And so, you know, when we think about that, we get so much from our plants that we can't get from our animal foods. You know, like we have to have fiber. And, you know, we need fiber for, we always talk about poop, but we need fiber not only for the poop, but also to keep our intestinal lining nice and smooth and intact, not having leaky gut and things like that. And, you know, and we, so there's so many different things we can talk about when it comes to eating a lot of animal foods. So way back when they were hunting, not only were they, you know, shooting the arrow, they were running through the woods. You know, they're sprinting and then they're relaxing. And can you imagine, you know, chasing an animal to kill it? You know, they're not, but maybe they were sitting in trees like the deer hunters do here, but you know, and they're out moving around and being active where we're not, you know, we're not trying really hard to get our foods, you know? And so there's a lot more to it than just eating meat too.
And then you look at modern day, the modern day people in the state of their health. Okay. Mm-hmm. And what is one of the number one killers still? It's heart disease. And so what are some of the, if we eat a lot of animal protein, what are some of the poor health outcomes that we can, they're usually prevalent in people that eat a lot.
Cancer.
Yes.
Cancer, kidney problems. So many people have kidney problems from eating too much red meat. Yeah. Stomach problems, constipation, high blood pressure, which you already said, heart disease.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And a lot of people want to argue, but if you really want to dive into this subject, there are so many scientific articles now that you can dive into as far as heart disease and the cancer, the cancer. One of the reasons it causes more cancer is because high protein intake for animals raises your IGF-1, which is a growth hormone, which can make certain cancers grow. Also, a lot of animal protein causes chronic inflammation in the body.
Yeah, we didn't even talk about inflammation, which can lead to all sorts of chronic conditions.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Raises our cholesterol levels, promotes inflammation, and so many people still eat, red meat and processed meat, ham, deli meat, and things like that. And even the World Health Organization, many, many years ago, I can't even remember how far back, it might even be close to 20 years ago, labeled those as possible carcinogens. And now they are known carcinogens. And so eating red meat and deli meat and processed meats, those, I mean, they're so harmful to our health, and we feed them to our children. Children are getting all these processed meats at an early age. And we give kids, like, what is the number one thing? You go to a picnic, or you have an event outside, hot dogs. So we're giving them cancer sticks when they're out eating. And so I think that's even more than what we were planning on talking about today. We were just talking about animal meat. I'm talking about eating meat, but I didn't mean to go out on a tangent. So let's talk a little bit about a little bit more about cancer and meat. So not only just raising the IGF-1, but it's strong links to colon cancer and things like that. I think a lot of that, oh my gosh, we can go in so many different ways. When the more meat you eat, if you're eating a lot of meat, then you don't really have a lot of room for your plant foods, the high fiber foods, which the average American, I can't remember what percentage, I want to say 5%, but don't quote me on that, of Americans get enough fiber, which is crazy ridiculous, because I get the 25 grams at breakfast on most days. And the fact that people don't even get that, and only, 5%, so 95% don't. And then you eat a high meat diet, there's nothing to help push this meat along. And so it sits in the colon. And that's when we start having problems, is it from sitting there. But then it can also be related to how the meat was cooked. We hear about acrylamides, and they're so high, in animal proteins. And so that can be so carcinogenic, that caramelized color. Now, I was a huge meat eater, so let me get that straight. So I was a huge meat eater until probably about 40. I mean, huge, hamburgers and hot dogs. I ate hamburgers and hot dogs. I was always eating meat. I'd go out on dates with my husband, I'd order ribs. I was just a huge meat eater, and I ate meat 3 times a day, and I love the burnt meat. I love the burnt hot dogs. And so, looking back, that, talk about cancer sticks, but that crispy burnt flavor, that smell, smelled so good, but that's so harmful to our bodies.
Especially at the high levels, Americans eat it. Like you're talking, you go to a steakhouse in America, they have a porterhouse 32-ounce steak. I mean, that's ridiculous. And it's at these higher levels that starts to cause a problem, I would think.
Yeah, and we're eating it 3 times a day, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Bacon or sausage at breakfast, this meat sandwich for lunch, and then dinner is centered around meat. That was one of the hardest things for me, transitioning from eating meat. Now, my husband was never a meat eater, but he was cheese, and I was not a cheese eater. But trying to transition to eating plant-based, it was like, how do we let go of the meat or the cheese? Because all of our meals are centered around the meat. It was like meatloaf and ribs and hamburgers and, chicken and. And so it's, you have to completely rethink the way that you are going to eat when that's the way you were born and raised. And that's so difficult for people, but it's also so important. So important. And so I'm getting off on another tangent. So let's bring it back in. So how does eating meat affect the kidneys?
Well, it's so much protein. See, animal source protein is highly concentrated amino acids, and it's got a lot of protein. So when the kidneys have to filter everything that you eat and take in through the air or the water. So when you're eating really, really high protein, your kidneys have to chronically try to filter these proteins. And if you're eating it 3 times a day, this starts to strain the kidneys. And I know you'll see studies saying that it doesn't. There's other studies showing that it does, especially in people. In America, They're finding that people over 50 years old, almost all of them already have their kidneys are already weaker. And they are now linking it to our high protein intake in America because people in America eat so much protein. There's this protein craze, and it's not, there's nothing scientific about it, it's marketing. The body doesn't need that much, and it's starting to strain our kidneys. And look, if you have ever known somebody on dialysis, it is a horrific place to be.
Yeah. And I was thinking that it also increases the water needed
Oh,
too. And so you lose water and it becomes more concentrated. And so it puts a strain on the kidneys, but it can also lead to kidney stones and, like you said, impairing the kidneys. And I forgot where I was going to go with that. Oh, with the amino acids, so high in amino acids, the body. So I saw a study where you cannot process more than 30 grams of animal protein in a meal. And so we have to think about that. And so many people, if you're eating, 30 grams is a lot, if you're tracking that. But if you're only eating 3 meals a day, that means your body can only process about 90 grams a day. And so how many people are consuming so much more? And we have bodybuilders that are taking in 30 grams per scoop, which is fine if that's in between their meals, but if they're having it with their meal, they're harming their kidneys that way too. And so that's just something else that we need to consider. And that protein, that scoop is usually from includes casein or whey, which is all animal proteins. And so maybe they think it's helping them with their muscles, but it's not helping them in the long run as far as kidney health goes.
There's also studies showing that these high protein diets for muscle building, it doesn't, you can eat 300 grams of protein a day, but it really doesn't build more muscle than maybe eating about 90 grams because it's, again, it's marketing. These people, they want to sell their protein powders.
Right. Yeah. The marketers are huge. And there's a huge reason why so many people think that they need to eat so much meat. But when you look at all the studies, you don't. And you can get all your protein from plants, all the protein that you need. And we're prime examples of that. How many years have you been eating all plants? And then you're a trainer.
Oh,
You're
yeah.
yeah.
10 years.
10 years. Yeah. And you're not wasting away.
No, I'm the same size as I was when I was eating a lot of meat. I mean,
Me too. And my husband, he's a farmer. Yeah, and he's out there, and we don't have a lot of equipment. He's doing everything by hand and squatting, and he really is doing the carrying the 50-pound bags, on his shoulders and stuff. And so there's no reason why you need the animal protein. So it can also have effect. Our digestive tract. And so that's something else that we need to consider. Just increasing the constipation that I talked about earlier, and then leading to diverticulitis and inflammatory bowel disease, and even Crohn's disease. And so for anyone who knows that they have genetic tendencies towards those, they need to watch their red meat intake.
I totally agree. I saw a study. There's a doctor. He had a study. He's a plant-based doctor, and he found that every time you eat meat, it causes, he found inflammatory gut bacteria. It was producing inflammatory gut bacteria, and they would find this out. They're using stool samples. And that was another reason he started to teach about eating plant-based because he knew that most all your health begins in the gut. And if your gut is inflamed, like you're just talking about, you're not going to be healthy because you can't digest anything and it's going to throw your immune system out of balance.
Right. And that reminded me of the heart too. Dr. Kim Williams says the people who, the cardiologist, so Dr. Kim Williams, he was the director, I believe, of the American Cardiac Association, or one of those. Anyway, he said that the cardiologists who still eat meat are the ones who haven't read the studies. You know, there's so many studies out there that, you know, so we were talking about digestive health, but back to the heart health, you know, there's just so many studies out there showing the harmful effects of eating animal protein.
Yeah, that's why I always focus on the most, because it's heart disease, because it's still our number one killer. It's taking a lot of people out in their primes. We're talking, there's studies now showing that people in their 40s are having more heart attacks than ever before.
Yeah.
And guess what else is increasing? Keto diets, carnivore diets. And look, I mean, you know, most people aren't willing to give up meat completely, but what is something that people can do to mitigate some of the health risks of eating meat?
Like eating lots of, not eating so much meat,
yes.
Replacing that meat with more plants, especially leafy greens. Yeah. I like to incorporate juices, you know, green juices to help get in all the minerals. You know, there's so many minerals that we're missing if we're only eating meat, and vitamins. It's just so important to get those. And so adding those things into our diet, eating more beans, you know, Dr. Greger and his Dirty Dozen, you know, says, you know, every day we need to have beans and nuts and seeds. Those are all high in protein, as well as your greens. You know, when it comes, you know, pound for pound, you know, you're probably not going to sit down and eat a pound of raw broccoli, but or kale, they have such a high percentage of protein in there. But, you know, once again, you would have to eat a whole lot, which is why I do like juices to get some of these other things in. I think a lot of people who have given up meat and then they say, I have to have it, it's because they're not eating enough calories. You know, when you think about it, you know, eating meat is so high in calories and fats that you don't get in these, especially if you're switching to leafy greens. You know, leafy greens have no calories. So when I show clients, you know, where that, what they're, how many calories they're eating, you know, you were eating this and now you're eating this, they're way under eating. And so they think that it's because they cut out the meat. Well, yeah, but it's, they didn't replace it with enough food. You have to eat a lot. And yes, when you under eat, like in our, one of our previous episodes, when you don't eat enough, it's too much stress on the body. It affects the hormones. And that can help with people, you know, who are trying to lose weight. If you switch from meat to plants, but then you're not eating enough, you may lose weight for a little while, but then you're not going to, it's going to stop. And you may even start gaining some weight because your hormones are going to switch saying, hey, we're starving, and throw everything off. And so you just have to, you have to really, you have to plan it well when you're making the transition. But once you get into it, it's so much easier. For people who do want to continue eating meat, they need to really consider, you shouldn't eat it 3 times a day. The best thing to do would probably be to crowd it out. You know, add vegetables to your meals, you know, slowly cut out. It's like one of the things that I did, because I wanted us to transition from eating animal products about 20 years ago. Didn't really do it until, I mean, I was completely 100%, a little over 7 years ago. But what I would do is I would add other foods to the meat. Like if I was cooking ground beef, I would add mushrooms or eggplant to it because it had that kind of the same texture. Just chop it and throw it in. And nobody knew the difference. You know, we added a spaghetti sauce. It was mostly mushrooms and eggplant, but everybody thought it was ground beef. And so I did that with a lot of foods. I would just start crowding it out, you know, where I, you know, instead of a pound of meat for this meal, it would go down to half a pound. And, you know, chicken breasts, we would get little chicken breasts and we'd split it, you know, things like that until we, you know, started tapering things out. And then adding in beans, because, you know, we'd eat baked beans, but, you know, all the sugar and the fat and the baked beans. And of course I had like the one that had the bacon in there, or the ham, you know, is making it without those things and without the sugar, and using different kinds of beans, because there's so many different types of beans and they're all high in fiber, which you don't get from meat, as well as vitamins and minerals, minerals that are important for your gut lining. In a lot of these starches, which are in beans and soy, which we, you know, it's not everyone has to avoid soy. It is a known allergen. If you have high inflammation and you haven't been tested for a soy allergy, then, you know, you shouldn't eat it until it's been tested. But for most people, soy is actually fine. We have another episode about that as well. What are your tips for getting rid of the meat?
I like to incorporate, I do like beans. I like to incorporate a lot of bean dishes in my diet. It's not necessary because it will give you a higher protein intake, but if you just eat enough calories from whole food plant-based, you can get all the protein you need even without beans. But I do recommend beans because you've seen the Blue Zone documentary. Those the people who live the longest, they all have one thing in common. They all eat beans on a regular basis. Beans are a powerhouse food. They have protein, they have a lot of minerals, they have fiber. Other things, like you're saying, one of the biggest problems people run into is if they switch to plant-based, they don't eat enough food. And one of my favorite things about this diet is you get to eat more and stay at a healthy weight. I mean, but because I'm a foodie, and I know Jennifer is too, and you get to eat more food and actually stay leaner.
So something else I thought would be good to talk about was, will you talk a little bit about the study that you saw about fasting and animal protein? Was it
Yeah.
fasting or intermittent fasting or calorie
Calorie
restriction?
restriction. Calorie restriction. For years, scientists have been studying calorie restriction in animals. And I think they would cut the calories around 30%. They would find the calories animals need to maintain, and they would cut that by around 30%. And when they would do this, the animals, the aging process would actually slow down. And there are other studies in humans where they would do this, and they would cut the calories about 30 or 40%, and they would start to age slower. Their blood pressure would drop. All these things would happen. But the problem they were finding is, especially in humans, is their hormones would start to fall, and they wouldn't have any energy, and their muscle mass would they would lose a lot of their muscle. So most people weren't willing to do this, but recent studies are finding it's not actually the total calories that matter, is actually the percent of protein. So now they're finding if you kept your protein at a certain level every day, you can still consume enough calories for your body weight, and you get the same benefits of calorie restriction. You actually get the slower aging, your blood pressure goes down. So you can get all these things on a normal calorie diet just as long as you keep your protein lower.
Yeah.
It's amazing, isn't
It
it?
really is. It really is. Yeah. When I meet with clients and I show them how much protein you really need, they're shocked.
Oh,
You
yeah.
really don't. Like, I remember learning way back in 1997, when I got my master's, that the only, like, that was way back when they said you had to food combine. You had to have a grain and a bean to get all of your amino acids. And now we know that that's not true. But back then, all you needed to get all the protein you needed in a day was a small can of tuna fish that would meet all of your amino acids. And I was like, what? Because back then I was eating junk food for breakfast. Well, maybe not at that age, but it definitely was in high school. But just that little can of tuna is really all the animal protein. And I'm not recommending canned tuna, but when you think about that, compared to what most people are eating, most people are eating more at breakfast than that little can of tuna, and then they're eating lunch, and then they're eating dinner.
Yeah, it's all unnecessary and it's putting a strain, and a lot of people develop health problems, and one of the reasons is excess protein. Actually, the diet recommendation is actually the opposite. Even as far as bodybuilding goes, and we talked about that earlier on this podcast, but I don't count protein anymore, and I still build muscle like I did when I was counting protein. It's all a lie.
Yeah, I don't
So
you need you don't need to pay attention to tracking and all of that. You need to pay attention to nutrients and colors. I interrupted you.
exactly. And like I said, they found that if you eat enough calories for your body to maintain your body, the protein will take care of itself. I don't care if you're eating protein-rich foods. It's just if you're eating whole grains, vegetables, fruits, you'll get what you need. The body needs amino acids. It uses amino acids and it builds its own protein. So
Right. Yeah, when we eat protein from plants, the amino acids from the plants, there's not much to break down, where when we eat them in meat, we're not most likely not eating raw meat. The meat is cooked, and we have to break down. When it's cooked, it's coagulated, and those are fibers, but they're not the same fibers our body needs. Those stick together. And so then when we eat, not only do we have to have really good stomach acid, which most people lose the older they get, you know, anyone who's taking Tums or antacids, they have very low stomach acid, the opposite of what they think they have 90% of the time. And so they have low stomach acid. As we get older, it goes down. And so we don't have the acid to break those fibers down. And if we do have, it takes a long time. It's a lot of hard work on the body to get those to break apart. And then they have to pass through our body. And then they have to get absorbed, where when we eat it from our plants, your body doesn't have to work as hard. We do still have to have good stomach acid no matter what we're eating, but it's going to be easier on the body, not as hard on the body, and it's going to pass through and be absorbed better when we eat it from our plants.
And one interesting note there is in older people, even meat eaters, a lot of older people are low in vitamin B12, which is one criticism of veganism, but even the meat eaters are becoming low in B12 because their body cannot break it down, because unfortunately the digestive system gets weaker as we get older. The acid is not as strong. There's not as much for a lot of people.
Right.
But, you know, so that's another misconception.
Right. Right. And if you don't have enough stomach acid, then it's going to pass through not as digested, and it's going to be harder to pass through the intestines and sit longer and create inflammation along the stomach walls.
Yeah, I think one key to longevity as we get older is to eat, pick foods that are easier for the body to process. And I think it's one reason a plant-based diet is so good for you, because, I mean, fruits are really easy for the body to break down. Most of your vegetables are easier. Meat is very hard for the body to break down. It's so complex, you know?
Right. If you just look at a cut of meat versus, you know, a bowl of mixed vegetables or fruits, you know, what are you more drawn to? You're drawn to those colors. We need those vitamins and minerals. And I also think that when we eat the way we need to eat, you know, as getting in all of our vitamins and our minerals and the leafy greens and the fibers, we feel really good. And when we eat something that we shouldn't eat, we feel off. And so it's like we get a little more in tune with our body. And we know, like, if you start working out more, then your body tells you, hey, I need more food. And so it's not saying, hey, I need more meat. It's, you know, I need more food. I need more calories. I'm burning more energy. You know, we're speeding up the metabolism. We do need to add some more food. But we get it more in tune with our body when we're eating the way that we should be eating. If we're not, if we're eating a high animal protein diet, we're not getting in the vitamins and the minerals and all that we need. Our body's still saying we need to eat food. But if we're not putting the right food in, our body's still going to be saying we need more food, which is how people, you know, just start gaining more and more weight. They're not getting the nutrition they need. And, you know, the body's not telling you exactly what you need to eat. It's saying we need more, because we're not getting those vitamins and the minerals that we need to thrive.
Yes, that's one thing they're finding now in the carnivore diet. A lot of people are becoming deficient in vitamins and minerals. Well, yeah, of course they are, because most of your vitamins and minerals are found in plant foods. And when you exclude those, where are you going to get them, you know?
Right, right. Yeah. And so something that we would like to do is we'd like for everyone listening, if you do eat animal products, and we'd like for you to find ways to get more plants into your day. And now if you don't eat any animal products, we want to know that too. So if you'll post in the comments, I don't eat animal products, or I'm doing the challenge, we'll call this the Plant Power Challenge. Doing the Plant Power Challenge. And so for this week, I am eating more plants each day. And so just find ways that you can get more in. So, you know, if you're thinking about breakfast, some people eat smoothies and things like that. You know, maybe you just add some berries to your breakfast. You know, that's adding another plant. You know, at lunch, maybe you're going to have something else on your salad. Maybe you're going to have, or maybe you don't normally have a salad. And so you'll have a side salad. Now, when you go out to eat, the salads you order are usually pretty wimpy. They don't have a lot of color. I know if I went out to eat and ordered a salad, I would probably be hungry and probably need two salads. And so just looking at different ways you can add more vegetables, you know, when you go to the grocery store, if you cook, unfortunately, some people don't cook, but, you know, going into the produce section, you know, what vegetable looks good to you today? Is there something you haven't tried yet today? If it's something, if you've never tried it, you know, for most vegetables, chopping it up, throwing it in the oven at 375 for 20 minutes until it's fork tender. You can stick the fork through there. Most vegetables, that's all you have to do to get them nice and tender, and you'll find them to be delicious. And so just trying new ways to try plants.
That's some good advice. Go ahead, Jennifer.
I'm sorry. I was say, let us know if you're doing the plant-based challenge, and let us know if you've already won it. I would say that we already won the plant-based challenge because we already eat lots of plants.
Oh yeah. And it's the best thing I've ever done.
Yes. Yes.
If you want more info, I mean, I recommend check out Dr. Esselstein. He's a good one. Dr. Fuhrman, Dr. McDougall, a lot of doctors out there that have been doing this for decades. And I, you know, the thing that really convinced me was the documentary Forks Over Knives. That was a good one. So
yes. And What the Health? What the Health on Netflix. I think that's what got my husband to give up cheese for good. I read a lot of things that kept wanting me to get more and more plant-based, but when I read How Not to Die, that's when I went completely 100%. I was like, that's it.
Yeah. Dr. Greger, Michael Greger.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyway, thank you for joining us today on Jen and Dan's Natural Healing with Plants. Once again, post Plant Power Challenge. We want to hear from you. Thank you for joining us, and I hope you join us again next time.